escaped it, didn't recall, but it, when I heard it was free lunch in here. Well, Max, founder of this group, Bill McCann, our finance director of it. Really a great pleasure to have you all here. Have a chance, hopefully, to say some deserved thanks to all of you for all that you've done. The challenges still lie ahead of us. You can see I got some notes to remind me of that so I can get in some licks here. But I think the most important thing right now is that our minds should be maintaining the majority in the Senate, doing what we can to see that we don't lose that majority. Because I don't think we could have had much of anything of what we've accomplished if we hadn't had that 1 month of the legislature to counter that almost 50-year history of both houses being in the other party's control. It sure did change the dialogue around here. And I know that you have been concentrating all your attention on support of Republican legislation, rather than just the 88 elections. The 86 one is the one we have to get by now, but it's the budget push and contra aid. Just had a meeting with our own leadership, Republican leadership, this morning in the Oval Office there on this contra aid situation. There's been a tremendous disinformation program going on. And right now, there's a group of Americans down there, including a former motion picture star, who are working to create a documentary film in favor of the Sandinistas for showing in the United States. There is a slick paper magazine already being published here in the United States, curiously enough, in Berkeley, California. But it is a magazine, if you pick it up and weren't aware, you find you were reading the straight outright propaganda. And then you come to that slip that's in most magazines and how to subscribe. And the urging on the slip is that the readers take out subscriptions for their senators and congressmen to them. So they're working hard, but there's just no escaping the fact that we have a last chance to reverse the kind of thing that happened in Cuba when we were all deceived some years ago. That's now with regard to right here on the mainland, turn this around. I think the Congress can do it. Maybe we go on to lunch. I know you're going to have more lunch than that, but I just take a lick of soup at a minute. Then my conscience is clear when they put that big dessert in front of me. It's going to be some time now. I think there's some games being played up there on the contrary. And maybe one of those games is to see if they can't attach it to some bill that would be almost impossible. But it would be impossible to veto. But then they could get, because of the contrary, but then they would get some licks in on some of the excessive spending that they want to do in time this month. So we're watching very closely. It's going to take some work, dedication, in order to get this through. We think we're reasonably close to having enough votes, but there's still some more that have to turn on that. The other thing that I know you're doing, and I think is vitally important, is that's the turnaround on getting young Americans registered to vote. Now, there were a few years ago, and I know all of us would have hoped that they didn't. But that generation has grown up now, at least physically. And these youngsters, I've had an opportunity to see them and be out of campuses and high schools, and then just last week to see a cross section up and down of Paris Island Marine Base training camp. And I have to tell you, the country's going to be in good hands come the next century. These young people, they're so different than that other generation we were talking about, we're thinking about. They're just really, and so gung-ho with patriotism and all that. It's an inspiration to go out there and see. In fact, the general was retiring at the end of the month, command down there this time, told me that in all his career in the military, he has never seen a higher type of young people in our military than we have today. And the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff said the same thing, that in 40 years in the Navy, he has never seen higher quality at that level of these young people. Well, I think it's time for us to eat. Supposed innocent deaths and so forth. We've got no way to prove it, but we're not sure that those were misfired bombs of ours or whether it was their own missiles coming.
That's what I thought right away too.
See, we had electronic stuff abroad aloft that could misdirect their missiles. So instead of targeting on planes, they were just shooting them like a barrage straight in the air and then turning and coming down. And where I got suspicious was when once we saw it on TV, they tried to prove they shot down a plane, and they had some stuff there in the street that they were...
Right, yeah, the debris.
Yeah, but you know what it was? It was one of their own Russian-made missiles that our people, military people, could identify as part of an airplane at all. So maybe did even better than we thought. We have one witness, however, from there who tells us that he was heavily present. One bomb misfire didn't go off, or we would have gotten Gaddafi.
Yeah.
That would have been great. Well, this is good to see you.
Well, thank you. Yeah. I'm doing really good. My vision is, I still cannot see out of the left peripheral vision in both eyes. But, like, I can't see anything over here. It's as if it never exists. But
straight ahead.
It's straight ahead on my head, and I can see stuff over here. But at first, when I came back, it was, I thought it was worse because everything it's like nothing had a wholeness. Everything was kind of separate. I look at something and it was an air. And now that's kind of come together. And then the depth perception is better to where I can go and touch something and I touch it. Whereas before I was kind of off to the right side a little bit. And that's gotten better. So it's improving. Getting a lot of it there.
Pretty rugged. Yeah, she is. She surprised me, I'll tell you.
That
brought out those qualities. I didn't know over there, I'll tell you that.
Getting shot was enough, but it didn't have to throw me downstairs.
Yeah. And that, we went into, I had a CAT scan done last week, and the doctor said everything was fine. And so the operation had all of the injection. And that I should only be laid up for probably 2 weeks.
Now that is...
Just to cover the hole. Put a plate.
Oh.
It's like a soft spot. You know, and so they're going to put a plate over the brain so that the skull will be rounded.
Just to bring back the natural contour.
Well, God bless you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for taking time. Yeah. See you. I appreciate it.
Good luck.
Take care.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming down on this. I think it's one of the most important issues that's confronting us. And I know that you're all on our side on one vote, and I'm just going to optimistically assume no one's changed their minds. But let me just say a few things about this. Another vote will be coming soon, we know. We vote. And this time, I think we have to, because each day the military situation in Nicaragua is twisting another degree to the bad side. And in the months since we made that initial request for assistance, Soviet supplied weapons in Nicaragua have mounted, censorship and other human rights violations have increased, and human suffering is growing. I've seen some of the less enthusiastic in the press question, well, how do we know that they have? We do know how the increase is on. As a matter of fact, when two ships in the Soviet Union at different times leave their port where they use that port for the export of munitions, and then are supposed to be sail for Cuba, go all the way down around the tip of South America and up the other coast to Nicaragua, and we think we've got reason to suspect that they're very terminus, the Sandinistas. If the House votes to support the Nicaraguan resistance democracy, I think in that nation can be given a chance. And again, the freedom fighters have proven their commitment to just this hope. Last month, they took steps to broaden their political base and increase their support among the Nicaraguan people. And with adequate training and supplies, they could mobilize the oppressed people of their country and win untold numerous troops. Last Friday, I had a brief visit with a Monsignor from down there who had asked to see me here. And his message was one very simple. He said the overwhelming majority of the Nicaraguan people look to us for salvation and will totally support an effort for their freedom that they're completely disillusioned with the present government. Our goal isn't a military solution, as you know. It might come down to that. But we think if the freedom fighters have what they need, this will give them the leverage to bring the communists to the table, negotiate a political and democratic solution. Three times they've offered to put down their arms and go to the table. Three times the communists have said no. And the Catholic Church in Nicaragua supported the internal reconciliation plan aimed at achieving democracy. And again, that was rejected by the Sandinista government. And the Contadora nations back to negotiating peace based upon internal reconciliation and democracy. The Sandinistas refused to grant these proposals serious consideration. We think there's hope. Just 10 years ago, less than a third of the people of Latin America lived in democracies, and today 90% of them do. It was only a few years ago that the same kind of talk that we're hearing against the Congress was being heard against the government of El Salvador. Today we have a democracy there. We still have guerrillas in the field, communist guerrillas out there. And now we're seeing the success of democracy. Honduras and Guatemala were both, not too long ago, military authoritarian regimes, and today they are democracies. And I think it is a rising tide that still flood Nicaragua if the House will take action on this aid. If the choice is to deny the resistance the help it needs and deserves, this would in fact grant permission to send the Sandinistas, I think, to ignore any pursuit settlement, pursuing material instead. But the final outcome is only too predictable, backed by a steady supply of arms, as I mentioned before, from the Cuban and Soviet states. The Sandinistas will be able to pin down the freedom fighters, surround them in time to oppression. whatever is left of the institution will be ever destroyed. We must protect our these fledgling nations of Central America. If we work together as we have in the past, we can demonstrate our bipartisan resolve to foster peace in the American hemisphere. And I don't think we can delay any longer. Every day is costing the freedom fighters down there dearly. Now, I'm not going to go on anymore myself here, but that George to add comment further on the development of the region. And we'll get those on tape.